With how ingrained social media has become in our lives, everything becomes an event. When something big, like a Marvel movie, comes out, it's this huge spectacle that everyone's talking for at least a week. Or when a big TV show like You or Euphoria comes that's widely accessible and just becomes a TikTok trend. But I think the one piece of media that has been affected by this, both positively and negatively, have been albums. Album rollouts aren't a new thing by any means, but I think the combination of streaming and social media has made them so important. And really, it's kind of changed the music industry post-2014 and how albums are released. If you need any more proof of that, just look at this year's Grammy nominations. You can go through that list and see how many of those songs got big from TikTok. And I just want to say, I'm not shitting on how albums are released now or any album rollouts. I actually kind of love how they are these days. There are multiple albums that I can kind of point out and remember how social media was that day or what got me hyped about them. And really just that full experience I think is pretty special. I remember back in 2017 when Kendrick Lamar posted the Roman numeral 4 on his Instagram. And holy shit, I have never been so excited by a number in my life. Of course, he was teasing The Heart Part 4, which would eventually release that Friday. And then the week after, he drops Humble. And then 2 weeks after that, he drops the album. That stretch of that album rollout was so special, so memorable, and it felt like such an experience. And it was all because of it just being pushed on social media and something that everyone was talking about. Whether you liked the album or disliked it, that Friday in April, everyone was talking about it. Even if you didn't listen to the fucking album, people were talking about the album cover. Like, how could you not say something about this? Look at the man. And that is what makes album rollouts so successful and so fun. Creating hype, living up to that hype, and creating an overall memorable experience. And I don't think album rollouts are just about what happens before the album. I think it's the before, the during, the after. Really the whole process of kind of just creating an era for an artist. And that's why I'm making this video, because I think there have been so many albums recently that have had such a good rollout that are so memorable and so special to me that I'm here to talk about my favorite album rollouts. And honestly, there is no better place to start than... This man wore the same suit for a full fucking year. GOAT. As a huge fan of The Weeknd, this album was really everything I could have asked for in an album rollout. The music, the videos, the performances, the suit, the fucking suit. We're all so consistent with each other. Like when he showed up to the AMAs with all these fucking bandages on him, only to release the Save Your Tears music video where he takes off the bandages and shows off this plastic surgery. That's some world-building ass shit for a fucking album. And after being quiet for quite some time, The Weeknd came back with some fresh new visuals and a new sound. Whenever I turn this album on, I can just visualize everything, all the music videos, the whole world of After Hours while I'm listening to the album. And that's such a special experience. Like, I am fully submerged into this world of After Hours. It's impressive because at this point in his career, The Weeknd could just pull a fucking Chris Brown, put 60 dog shit songs on an album, make his money and call it a day. But he still puts the work to make such a quality product and such a quality experience for his fans. And obviously he's currently doing this also with Dawn FM, which I think he's doing just as well as he did with After Hours. The dude is just a very special artist and we're very lucky to have him. And speaking of good music and a man in a suit, Tyler, the Creator, really is the standard for album rollouts right now, I think. He consistently releases an album every other year around the same point, and it always has a fresh new sound and its own distinct look to it. And honestly, I couldn't decide which one I liked more, the IGOR rollout or the Call Me If You Get Lost rollout, so fuck it, both. Most recently, he did this with Call Me If You Get Lost. The whole album had this branding to it that I absolutely loved. It looked good, it sounded good, it felt good. And then I remember leading up to it, you could actually call this number and you would hear the little jingle that he has. Similar to IGOR, he has his own look to his performances. He's always wearing some bougie-ass shit that I certainly can't afford, and he's always carrying around a suitcase like, hey, get in, idiot. And unfortunately, I'm not at the place in life where I am this world-renowned traveler, but every time I listen to this album, I'm just like, fuck it, I'm in Switzerland. The rich, luxurious vibe really complements the album, and the same can be said for IGOR. The blonde wig and the colorful suits that he wore really gives me a visual of this like IGOR character, and it's really fitting for the album. And combine that look with some of the most insane performances I have ever seen. You've got yourself a pretty good album rollout. And we cannot talk about great performances in a rollout without talking about... How do you follow up Good Kid, Mad City, one of the best albums of all time? You drop another classic, that's how. This was when Kendrick really solidified himself as one of the greatest artists of all time. This was one of the most anticipated albums of all time. I remember being in high school so excited for whatever Kendrick was gonna release next, on my little fucking iPod Touch, scrolling through news every day, trying to hear anything I could about his next album. I remember when I first found a leak of King Kunta and just listening to it like, what the fuck is this? This shit is hard. I had never heard anything like that before. I was so excited that I was planning on faking sick from school that day just so I could sit and listen to the album on repeat, just close my eyes and just keep hearing the album. So when it came out randomly a full week early, you can imagine how pissed I was. I had been looking forward to this shit and it decides to drop right Monday morning when I'm going to English class. But that didn't matter at all, because when I put my earbuds in, I was completely blown away by what I was hearing. The chaos of the To Pimp a Butterfly album rollout is really what makes it so memorable. No one was expecting it to drop a week earlier than it did, so everyone was kind of just in shock together. And I remember seeing just a bunch of rappers talking about how great the album was. Like I said, everyone got this at the same time in surprise, so everyone was kind of just laying out their knee-jerk reaction. It was just cool to see a bunch of people just recognize how special of an album and a special of a moment this was for Kendrick. And Kendrick didn't just stop after dropping such a critically acclaimed album. He followed it up with some of the best performances I have ever seen. I'm on one, homie, you on one, but if God does, then we gon' be all right. These performances that he was doing on TV were so good, in fact, that he got the LeBron James, you know, LeBron James, the guy who invented the deluxe album.
We got 16 tracks, right? The 16 tracks, we want to do 14. But is there a problem with a week or 2 weeks after the album drop with the 14 tracks that we add the deluxe album and add the two songs back on?
I think that's hard.
I think it'd be a conversation of, oh shit, this man has some more, but he couldn't fit it into the album. Thank y'all for taking on this ride with me. Yeah. You know what? Here go two more for y'all. Yeah.
LeBron said that Kendrick should release the music that didn't make the album into its own album of unreleased music. And he did just that. The fact that Kendrick's To Pimp a Butterfly leftovers are better than most rappers' full-length albums just goes to show of how insane of an artist he is. And really just capped off this To Pimp a Butterfly era so perfectly. But in terms of album rollouts, there is one man, specifically one album, that I put above this and I think is the best album rollout of all time. We on a ultralight beam, we on a ultralight beam, this is a God dream. The Life of Pablo by Kanye West is an experience that I will never, ever forget. This album rollout had so much shit attached to it. Name changes, tracklist changes, delays, being title exclusive, and even a fucking Wiz Khalifa beef? What? This shit is just fucking insane that happened around this time. While technically you can probably say this album rollout happened around 2015 when it was being called So Help Me God, and it had songs like 4 or 5 Seconds and All Day attached to it, it didn't really start, in my opinion, until New Year's Day of 2016, when he released the single Facts. And let me tell you, this single sucked. This song was fucking trash. Like, this shit was so bad. Any song that's sole purpose is like a diss to Nike and mentions Bill Cosby, it is just gonna be a miss from me. I'm not, that shit's not hitting my airway. My car is not listening to that. But that did not matter one bit, because he would go on to follow that up by releasing Real Friends, No More Parties in LA, and 30 Hours. And I cannot tell you how hyped these songs got me for this album. No More Parties in LA still doesn't feel like a real song to me. I feel like I never fully digested everything I heard in that. That beat is insane. And Kendrick's verse is perfect. It's incredible, which is insane because Kanye's is even better. I had no idea how this album was gonna sound, but I was ready for whatever Kanye was gonna give us. And the thing I absolutely loved, probably my favorite thing about the whole album rollout, was the track list that got tweeted around. Like, we gotta see all of the changes to this little piece of paper with the songs, and just seeing the album evolve and complete in front of us was both frustrating but mainly pretty cool and pretty memorable. It felt like Kanye was taking us along on the creative journey with him. And then he released the album cover art. And we have to talk about this because at the time, I hated this so much. I thought this shit looked like ass. I thought he went on Microsoft Paint. He's like, fuck it, this looks fine. I'll add some words, add some pictures, and yeah, it's orange. But enough time has passed that I can look back at how iconic this cover is. And honestly, it's probably one of my favorite covers of all time now. I'm sure if the album sucked and I didn't like any of the music, I would kind of hate the cover, but fuck it, the album didn't suck. It slapped hard as hell, so I do love the cover. And as we were getting closer to the album's release, Kanye had this big listening party slash fashion show at Madison Square Garden. And again, there is so much to unpack with this album, and honestly, just this show alone. Like, Lil Yachty was there as one of the models for some reason. And the weirdest moment being when Young Thug kind of just gets the aux cord. Thug, baby. Fuck all that, let's get to it. Like, what? But most importantly, the event blessed us with this clip. Simpler time. But then the album finally released, and oh my god, my ears were blessed. The first time I'm hearing Father Stretch My Hands Part 1, I was being elevated. I was lifting off the ground. It was just banger after banger after banger after Facts, Charlie Heat edition, after banger. This album came out when I was in my freshman year of college, and I just remember going over to my friend's house later that night, and we just had this album playing front to back on repeat. We couldn't stop listening to it. We fucking loved it, every second of it. The 2 months leading up to the album felt like one huge event, in just waiting in anticipation, and getting the album being as good as it was, it really just felt like it was the cherry on top of such a memorable, great experience. After release, Kanye took the album on tour with the Saint Pablo Tour. And if I had a time machine and I could go back to just one moment, I would go back to any of these Saint Pablo performances. They looked so good, and I will never forgive myself for not finding a way to go see this album. He had this huge elevated stage that would just hover over the crowd of people, which is pretty insane. But every clip I saw of the performances of Mike Dean there, it just sounded so good. And it looked like such a time. I am a dummy. I'm an idiot. I'm so stupid for not finding a way to go to this. Like, this shit looks like it's something out of a movie. Which is all perfect. The tour ended perfectly, so perfectly. He definitely didn't do anything controversial that would cause a lot of chaos in his life and in the media, right? Hopefully he doesn't go give a speech following the 2016 election. Oh no, he's got headphones on. Kanye, no!
But if I would've voted, I would've voted.
For since from the hit game, Undertale.
As I said before, there's so much stuff that happened in this album roll that made it so perfect. 2 months of hype, followed by an album that lived up to that that hype, and then the album becoming a class. It's really as good as it gets, especially when you think about how hard it is to deliver an album up to expectations. Sometimes albums fall extremely short, and sometimes once in a blue moon, they turn into an absolute disaster train wreck. And I really cannot end this video without mentioning what I think is the worst album rollout of all time.
Ooh, I love my wife. I love my wife.
The big day, more like the bad day for Chance. Am I right? I have never seen an album rollout get as bad as The Big Day by Chance the Rapper did. Chance was rap's glory child. He was supposed to be on that Drake level, and honestly, he was for a little bit. He didn't have any promo leading up to The Big Day, and he really didn't need it. He was so well known. He was pretty much a household name at this point. He had an incredibly strong personal brand with the three hat that he would always wear, which he still somehow wears for some reason, though he's past his third album. Like, this dude was in Super Bowl commercials.
Flamin' Hot Nacho.
I love my wife.
And he was even arguably probably the best part of the album I just talked about in The Life of Pablo. Like, this dude went from his verse on Ultralight Beam and made The Big Day. What? Nobody could have seen the absolute downfall that Chance was about to go through. Well, the first sign that this might start turning into a train wreck for Chance was when he put out the album cover. This shit looks fucking terrible. I cannot believe that he felt like this was a good cover to have out there. Just look at his other three albums. They're all way better than this looking. Even 10 Day, back before he had any of the money he has now, has a much better cover than this. Like, that shit looks creatively bankrupt. And the track list, it's not bad. But if you consider this track list for The Big Day and compare it to Coloring Book, it's just unreal the difference in quality. Coloring Book had rap superstars, big names. It felt like such a big album attached to it because everyone came together and made this album. This one, on the other hand, Shawn Mendes? It just felt so cheap when I was looking at the feature list. But surely the music would save this album. No. When I listened to the album for the first time, there were specifically two jaw-dropping moments for me. The first one being Hot Shower. I couldn't believe that he put out such a dog shit song. The hot damn hot water hot shower. That shit made me feel like I was in preschool. Like, that's some shit the teacher tosses on in the background as you're doing those shape puzzles trying to figure out where the circle goes. Oh, where the fuck's the square? Hot damn hot water hot shower. The second jaw-dropping song for me was the song The Big Day. I was so confused because I couldn't figure out why Chance was doing some Ja impression. Like, what is this song? What? Why did he think this was okay to do? But hey, this isn't about the album. This is about the album rollout. I mentioned in the beginning of the video when Damn came out, everyone was talking about the album, and mostly in a pretty good way. This album was the complete opposite. Everyone was shitting on this album the second it came out. Like, a full ass week, we got just nonstop Chance the Rapper hate. It even produced the iconic "Ooh, I Love My Wife" video.
My wife's real young, my wife's real small. Let's go to the beach and play with a beach ball. Praise Jesus, God, and my wife. Let's go to the beach and ride a bike.
And hey, I'll tell you what, this shit goes a lot harder than anything on the album. And in fact, it's the first thing I think of when I think about this album. It's literally a Chance impression. It was so hated that people were rooting for NF to get the number one album that week. And he did. Imagine going back to 2016 to tell yourself that Chance the Rapper was going to get outsold by NF in his next album. I would have thought you were a lunatic going back in time. Having a bad album is one thing, but I think the way that Chance started fighting his own fans and defending any criticism of the album is really what killed the rollout. That is like textbook what not to do when you release an album. Because of this result and this album and the whole rollout in general, it has ruined his image. I have never seen someone fall the way that Chance did with this. He's lost a lot of respect. Obviously, other things have happened around him, kind of like his fight with his manager that's not looking very good for him. But honestly, who am I to say how artists should handle their album rollouts or anything like that? It's their art at the end of the day, and all I can truly attest to are the rollouts that are very memorable to me, that are so special to me that I'm never going to forget. And even though the Big Day's rollout sucked, never gonna forget that. At the end of the Big Day, I think we can all sit back and just be pretty thankful that we live in a time where we can listen to an album the second it rolls out, and in that very same second, we can call it mid. But those are just a couple albums that I wanted to talk about. Some of my favorite album releases, and obviously one of that I don't like. Let me know what you think. Let me know what your favorite album rollout is. Maybe I'm wrong about The Big Day. Maybe you hate The Big Day too. Are there any albums that you remember fondly? I wanna know. And hey, maybe hit that like and subscribe button too while you're at it. It's a thought. Thanks for watching.